Hello students, so in the last video we had seen that if a function f is continuous in the closed interval ab, then it is also remain integrable. And at the end I had also remarked that this condition is a sufficient condition, but it's not a necessary condition for integrability. That is, there are many functions which are not continuous in the closed interval AB, but even then they are integrable. So let us have a look at this theorem, which says that a bounded function f from AB to R, having a finite number of discontinuities on the interval AB, is integrable. Right. So if there are finite number of discontinuities in the interval, even then the function is integrable. So how to prove that? So let f from AB to R be bounded, and let C1, C2 up to CP, so be P points of discontinuity. So we are supposing that there are finitely many discontinuities. So we know how many discontinuities are there. So we can always assume that C1 is strictly less than C2, less than C3, less than CP. So we start with any epsilon greater than 0. So we can choose a partition P, x0, x1 up to xn of AB, such that the points of discontinuities are enclosed in non-overlapping subintervals. That is, each CR belongs to exactly one subinterval xj minus 1 to xj. Okay, and each subinterval xi minus 1 to xi contains at most one point of discontinuity, that is CR. Right, since we know the points C1, C2 up to CP, so this can be done. We can choose a partition in such a way that each subinterval contains at most one discontinuity, and each point of discontinuity is contained in exactly one subinterval. Thus, the subintervals of P can be grouped into two categories: those which contain a point of discontinuity and those which do not contain any points of discontinuity. Okay, so let us rename those intervals. So let the subinterval that contains the point of discontinuity CR be renamed as YR minus 1 to YR for R equal to 1 to up to P. So we have exactly P subintervals of the partition P, which each of which contains a point of discontinuity. And let the other subintervals be renamed as ZS minus 1 to ZS, where S takes values from 1 to up to N minus P. So remaining N minus P subintervals, they do not contain any points of discontinuity. That is, F is continuous on each closed interval ZS minus 1 to ZS, and hence uniformly continuous. So since a continuous function on a closed interval attains its bounds, so in last class also we have seen, so the capital MS, that is the supremum of Fx in the interval ZS minus 1 to ZS, will be equal to f of us for some point inside that interval. Similarly, infimum, that is small ms, will be equal to f of vs for some point vs inside that interval, right? And let capital Z equal to union of ZS minus 1 to ZS, then Z is also compact, because this union is also union of a finite number of closed intervals. It's closed and it is also bounded, so it's compact. So since f is uniformly continuous on a compact set Z, so for above epsilon greater than 0, so there exist delta 1 greater than 0, such that mod of fx minus fy, this is less than epsilon by 2 into b minus a, for every xy in Z which satisfy mod of x minus y less than delta 1. Okay, so whenever mod of x minus y less than delta 1, we will have mod of fx minus fy is less than epsilon by twice b minus a, right? So there is a reason for choosing epsilon by 2 into b minus a, we will see. So now what is UPF minus LPF? So remember, this is for any partition P chosen as part the above discussed criterion. So we can group it into two parts. One is corresponding to those YR minus 1 to YR, and another part is corresponding to ZS minus 1 to ZS. So for the part corresponding to YR minus 1 to YR, this part is less than or equal to capital M minus small m. Capital M is the supremum of f in the whole interval AB. Small m is the infimum of f in the whole interval AB. So obviously capital MR is less than or equal to capital M and small MR is greater than or equal to small m. So ultimately this quantity will be less than or equal to capital M minus small m. So that can be taken outside. Plus I substitute the values of MS and small MS here, and then again I can write this is less than or equal to capital M minus small m into P. There are P such quantities and each of these quantities is less than the norm of the partition. So P into norm P, norm capital P, plus summation S goes from 1 to N minus P of F of US minus F of VS multiplied with ZS minus ZS minus 1. Now we are to choose one common value of delta such that for every partition with norm P less than delta, this quantity UPF minus LPF is less than epsilon. So we will choose delta to be minimum of delta 1 that we had got using the uniform continuity criteria, and another quantity that we will get from this term. From this term we see if norm P is less than epsilon by 2 into P into M minus M, then this total quantity is less than epsilon by 2. So this expression actually gives us an idea of choosing the delta. So delta is minimum of these two quantities. Thus for any partition P of AB with norm P less than delta, we will have UPF minus LPF. So this quantity is less than minimum of this two, the above two. So ultimately it is also less than epsilon by 2 P into M minus M. And this quantity epsilon by 2 into B minus A, this quantity FS minus FUS minus FVS is less than epsilon by 2 into B minus A. So this part can be taken outside. It will be multiplied with sum of the lengths of this interval. And again I can write this is strictly less than epsilon by 2 plus epsilon by 2 into B minus A multiplied with B minus A, because the sum of all these lengths, the sum of all these lengths is strictly less than the total length of the interval B minus A. Okay. So these are the lengths of the subintervals. So the total sum of the subintervals, length of subintervals is less than the length of the original interval. So ultimately we have got UPF minus LPF is less than epsilon for every partition P with norm P less than delta. So hence F is integrable. So here I have written the thing. Note that this is this quantity is less than the total length of length B minus A of the interval AB. So any function having finitely many points of discontinuities in AB is always remain integrable. Now let us have a look at algebra of integrable functions. If we are given two integrable functions, then f plus g is also integrable. Then if you are given an integrable function and a constant, then constant multiplied with that integrable function is also integrable. Okay. So we have these results. For k belongs to R, the function kf is always integrable, and integration of kf is k times integration of fx. That means constant can be taken outside. Yeah, this is something that we have been using since our higher secondary days. So this constant can be taken outside. So we will see the proof now. And if f and g are integrable, then f plus g is also integrable, and integration of f plus g is same as integral f plus integral of g. Okay, this also we have been using the result. So we will see the proof now. If fx is greater than or equal to 0 for every x inside ab, then integration of a to b fx is also greater than or equal to 0. And a corollary of that result, if fx is greater than or equal to gx for every x in ab, then integration a to b f dx is always greater than or equal to integration a to b g dx. Right, so let us start with the proof of a. So if k is 0, then kf is the zero function, which being a constant function is integrable, and integration a to b kf dx will be 0 into b minus a. We have already seen the integral of the constant function is k times b minus a, so it's 0 into b minus a. So it is 0, and ultimately this can be written as 0 multiplied with a to b f dx. So it's trivially satisfied. Let k greater than 0 and let epsilon greater than 0 be given. Then for any partition P, supremum of k fx will be k into supremum of fx. This result follows from the properties of supremum and infimum that we had done in second semester. These are already done. So if k is positive, then this k can be taken outside and the supremum will remain as supremum. So it is k multiplied with capital MI. And infimum of kx similarly is k multiplied with the infimum of f over the subinterval xi minus 1 to xi. So upkf minus lpkf is k times of mi minus k times of small mi. So k can be taken outside. So it is k into upf minus lpf. So immediately from here, we can see that if we make this quantity less than epsilon by k, then our job is done. And we can do that because f is integrable. Since f is integrable, so for the above epsilon greater than 0, there exists a partition p such that upf minus lpf is strictly less than epsilon by k. So, but one is true for any partition. The thing that we have proved, this number one in equation one, it is true for any partition. So, it is particularly true for this partition that we have got. So, upkf. So, ultimately, we have got a partition P such that upkf minus lpkf is strictly less than epsilon, and hence kf is integrable, right? Also, what is integration a to b kf dx? It is infimum of all the upper sums. So this k can be taken outside, k into infimum of all upper sums of f, and then again k is positive, so k can be taken outside. So k into infimum of this, and this is nothing but integration a to b f dx since f is integrable, right? So there is another way of doing the same thing. You can observe that we had done one theorem that if f is integrable, if there exists a number I such that for every epsilon there exists a partition such that upf minus I is less than epsilon. So we are using that result. So for k greater than 0, we have upkf is k types of upf, and therefore upkf minus k into a to b f dx. So we will directly show that this quantity is nothing but the integral of kf. So we can take k outside just as before that I had shown, since k is positive. So k into upf minus a to b f dx. So immediately we see that since f is integrable, so for epsilon greater than 0, we can find a partition such that this difference is strictly less than epsilon by k, and immediately we get upkf minus k times of a to b f dx is strictly less than epsilon. Similarly, upkf minus k times of a to b f dx is less than epsilon. Hence, kf is integrable, and integration of a to b kf, this will be kf, sorry, this will be kf, right, this is kf dx. Okay, so this is kf dx. Equal to k into integration b a to b f dx. So for k greater than for k less than 0, it's similar. upkf will be k into lpf. All of this follow from the properties of infimum and supremum. Okay. And similar arguments will follow. Now let us try for the sum of two integrable functions. So for any partition p of a b, let m fi, m gi, m f plus g of I, and m fi, small m gi, small m f plus g of I be the supremum and infimum of f, g and f plus g respectively. Okay, so we have fx lies between small m fi and capital M fi, and gx lies between small m gi and capital M gi for every x inside xi minus 1 to xi. And so we can add them up. So mfi plus mgi less than or equal to fx plus gx less than or equal to this. So ultimately we have seen this quantity mfi plus mgi and capital mfi plus capital mgi are the lower and upper bounds of f plus g in this interval, right? But what is small m f plus g of I? It is the greatest lower bound and this is the least upper bound. So we have this inequality. So immediately we multiply this inequality by delta xi, that is xi minus 1, length of each subinterval and then take the summation. So we will end up with LPF. This quantity is LPF, right? This quantity is LPG, and this quantity is LPF plus G. This quantity is the next one, UPF plus G. This is your UPF, and this quantity is your UPG, right? So we have this inequality. LPFF plus LPG is less than or equal to LPF plus G, less than or equal to UPF plus G, less than or equal to UPF plus UPG. And so if you split it into two parts and see the last two part and the first two part, multiply the first two part by minus 1, so we have this, and you add them up, so it is 0 less than or equal to UPF plus G minus LPF plus G. Upper sum is always greater than the lower sum, so that is why it is greater than or equal to 0. So we have this. So now we have an idea that since F is integrable, we can make this quantity less than epsilon by 2. And since G is integrable, so we can make this less than epsilon by 2. And the sum of these two will be less than epsilon. So let epsilon greater than 0 be given. Since F and G are integrable, so there exist partitions P1 and P2. So this is very important. The same partition P may not work. So we have to start with P1 and P2 of AB, such that UP1F minus LP1F is less than epsilon by 2. UP2G and LP2G is less than epsilon by 2. Okay, and then we take the refinement of P1 and P2. So P is the common refinement of P1 and P2. So immediately we have the refinement decreases the upper sum and increases the lower sum. We have already seen. So from the above two and from these refinement inequalities, we have the same partition P satisfies both UPF minus LPF less than epsilon by 2. The same partition P will also satisfy UPG minus LPG less than epsilon by 2. So in equation 2 was true for any partition, and in equation 3 it is true for the particular partition that we have already obtained. So we can apply both to see that UPF plus G minus LPF plus G is strictly less than epsilon. Hence F plus G is integrable. Now the next part that remains is we have to show integration of A to B F plus G is same as integration of F plus integration of G. So we already have this result that LPF plus G is less than integration F plus G dx less than UPF plus G for any partition. Okay, this is true for any partition, because if we go to the definition of the integral, the lower integral is the supremum of all lower sums, and the upper integral is the infimum of all upper sums, right? So since F plus G is integrable, so upper and lower integral are the same. Okay, so this quantity is the supremum of LPF plus G. This quantity is also infimum of all the UPF plus G. Okay, so it is also true for any partition. So by 1 and 4, if you now compare 1 and 4, what was 1? 1 was this, LPF plus LPG less than or equal to LPF plus G. So in between LPF plus G and UPF plus G, we have a quantity here, that is integration A to B F plus G dx. That means you can say integration A to B F plus G is a upper bound of LPF plus LPG, and it is a lower bound of UPF plus UPG. Okay, so that is what we will say here. So by 1 and 4, integration A to B F dx, F plus G dx is a lower bound of this collection of the set of all UPF plus UPG, such that P is a partition of AB. And what is this integration A to B F dx plus integration A to B G dx? It is the greatest lower bound of the same collection. So this should be less than or equal to this, right? Similarly, integration A to B F plus G dx is an upper bound of this collection, LPF plus LPG, but this sum is the least upper bound, okay? Because it is the least upper bound of LPF, this one, and integration A to B GDX is the least upper bound of LPG, right? So their sum is the least upper bound of the collection of all LPF plus LPG. So we have integration A to B FDX plus integration A to B GDX less than or equal to this. So comparing 5 and 6, we have integration A to B F plus GDX is same as integration A to B F dx plus integration A to B G dx. So now there is a note here that if we combine the results A and B, we can actually show that, or it directly follows that it A to B f dx, A to B alpha f plus beta g dx, where alpha and beta are any constant. This is equal to alpha A to B f dx plus beta A to B g dx for any alpha and beta in R. Right, so it's a linear property. The next one is, given fx is greater than or equal to 0 for all x, so this is quite simple. Thus, for any partition P, we have fx greater than or equal to 0 for every x in the subinterval. So, small mi is what? Infimum of all this. So, infimum is the, infimum of all this. So, 0 is a lower bound, but infimum is the greatest lower bound. So, we will have mi is greater than or equal to 0. So, mi into xi minus 1 is greater than or equal to 0, and then we take the sum. So, LPF is greater than or equal to 0. So, this is true for any partition. So, the collection of all LPF for this particular function is a collection of non-negative real numbers. Right? So, since f is integrable, this lower integral and upper integral are same as the integral a to b f dx. So, integration lower integral is again the supremum of all lower sums. And each of these lower sums are greater than or equal to 0. So, supremum has to be greater than or equal to 0. So, we have integration a to b f dx is greater than or equal to 0. Right? So, using this result, we can also show that if fx is greater than or equal to gx, so you bring gx to the other side. So, we have f minus g of x is greater than or equal to 0. Now, use the earlier result. Integration a to b f minus g dx, this will be greater than or equal to 0. And then use the results a and b. So, taking k equal to minus 1. So, we can conclude that f minus g is also remain integrable. And integration f minus g is integration f minus integration of g. And then change the sides. So, integration a to b f dx is greater than or equal to integration a to b g dx. So, these are the results. So, in the next lecture, we will see some more properties of the Riemann integral. Then there are mean value theorems as well, and the fundamental theorem of integral calculus. So, thank you.